Hello and welcome to Petroleum Bites. Today we'll talk about hydraulic fracturing, commonly known as fracking. It's one of stimulation techniques that is used in oil and gas industry to enhance wells production. In this lesson, we'll explore the fundamental aspects of hydraulic fracturing in terms of frac main geometries and propagation directions, in addition to equipment and material involved in treatment execution, and finally end up with the optimum candidates for performing a frac treatment. So let's get started. So what is hydraulic fracturing? Fracking is the process of maximizing formation floor area to the wellbore. This can be accomplished by pumping a frac fluid into the rock at a pressure high enough to break down formation rock. To keep created frac open, to prevent formation closure back, a proppant, which is a man-made permeable sand, is pumped along with the frac fluid. This action helps with enhancing well productivity and maximizing formation fluid flow to the wellbore. Let's understand how hydraulic fracturing improves well productivity. Darcy Law gathered all contributing elements in rock and fluid property that affect flow rate. Fluid is flowing radially to wellbore, passing through damage zone and through only open wellbore area that is controlled by wellbore radius. As you can see, all parameters in the equation related to rock and reservoir fluid property cannot be changed. Only wellbore radius and skim factor are changeable parameters in this equation. And that's exactly what the frac is working on. Hydraulic fracturing creates a highly conductive path that bypasses near wellbore damage zone and maximizes contact area with the reservoir, allowing more fluid production from the reservoir with less resistance to fluid flow. It's almost similar to drill and complete a well with a larger wellbore radius. Created frac has two main wings. Each wing has three main geometries. Firstly, frac half length, which is the horizontal distance from the wellbore to the tip of created fracture. It's a measure of fracture penetration in the reservoir. Secondly, frac height, which is the vertical length of created frac from top to bottom. And finally, frac width, which is the opening width of created frac. It's a very important geometry and has a direct relationship to fracture conductivity. To understand frac propagation direction, it's essential to consider in situ stresses within the rock formation. The rock at downhill condition is subjected to three stresses: the overburden vertical stress, which is the weight of overlaying rocks, and two horizontal stresses, the maximum and minimum horizontal stress. Generally, in most cases, vertical overburden stress is the biggest of all downhill stresses. Downhill stresses influence how fracture propagate during the fracking process. Always fracture propagate in the direction of the least resistance, which is typically perpendicular to the least principal stress. Recognizing downhill stresses pattern helps engineers optimize well drilling survey and fracture design for better productivity. Next, let's illustrate the main stages of a frac pumping schedule. The process generally involves several key phases. Mini frac, also known as data frac. In this stage, a certain volume of frac fluid is pumped into the formation before pumping the main treatment in order to calibrate the main treatment design and to get some key information like system friction pressure loss, formation closure pressure, and fluid leak-off behavior into formation. Pad stage is the first stage of the main frac treatment. It consists only of frac fluid. The main objective of this stage is to create main frac geometry and provide enough volume to place proppant coming in next stages. The proppant slurry stages. In this stage, proppant is mixed and pumped with the frac fluid. Proppant concentration is gradually increased till it reaches maximum concentration value just before starting the flush stage. Flush stage. It's the last stage of main treatment pumping schedule. It's a fluid-only stage that sweeps all proppant frac string and place it in the created frac. After pumping flush stage, frac treatment is completed. Moving on to frac fluid, it's the heart of the frac treatment. The fluid must have several properties in order to execute frac treatment without any concern, as it should always be available to easy and gather and mix. That's why water is used as the base of the most of frac fluid systems. Also, it should have enough viscosity to be able to carry proppant and minimize frac fluid loss to formation during job execution. Compatibility with formation fluid is essential to avoid forming of any emulsion or sludge that may cause formation damage. And finally, ease of recovery after finalizing treatment placement. The frac fluid has two main functions. First is to create frac geometry and make space of proppant to be placed. And second is to carry proppant and transport it from surface down into created frac in the reservoir rock. Frac fluid consists of several additives that give the system the unique property of high viscosity, less formation damage, stability at high temperature, and low friction pressure loss during pumping. The first additive is the gelling agent. It's the ingredient responsible for increasing viscosity of the water. In most cases, a natural polymer is used. It's made of processing seed of plant called guar and turned to fine powder polymer. Cross-linking is the most effective means of increasing viscosity of fracturing fluid without increasing the amount of gelling agent used, as cross-linker material links between gelling agent polymer chains and increases viscosity by several folds. Breakers are chemicals that literally break the viscosity of the fracturing fluid by reducing the molecular weight of the polymer. There are two main types of breakers, oxidizers and enzymes. The action of breaking is triggered by temperature and time, and both are related to the amount of used breaker. Polymer of gelling agent is perfect meal for bacteria. Therefore, bactericides are added to prevent viscosity loss caused by bacterial degradation of the polymer. Stabilizers are used to prevent degradation of gel, especially when frac fluid is used in high downhole temperature that are close to or higher than water boiling point. The commonly used stabilizers are methanol and sodium thiosulfate. Surfactants are used to reduce surface tension between frac fluid and formation fluid, which makes fluid recovery easier after fracturing operation. Stability of formation clay is crucial to prevent any subsequent damage. Solutions containing potassium chloride are commonly used as the base liquid in fracturing fluid to stabilize clay and prevent swelling. Friction reducers reduce the friction and associated consumed horsepower requirements for pumping operation. In addition, it also provides requirement maintenance and protection for equipment against wear. Now moving to proppant. Proppant must have several properties to perform its function on a proper way. First, proppant grain must be acceptable range of roundness and sphericity. As for natural sand, it should be at least 0.7 on both scales. And in man-made proppant, it should be no less than 0.9 on the same scale. The proppant should have optimum strength compared with formation strength. If formation strength is higher than proppant, then proppant will be crushed. And if formation is softer than proppant, proppant will be embedded into the rock. Particle size has a direct effect on proppant pack permeability. Bigger proppant size yield higher permeabilities and vice versa. Proppant density help with proppant transportation, especially in a long fracture length. Lower density proppant can be transported deeper into the reservoir, which maximizes effective frac geometry. The proppant has two main functions. First, to support and keep created frac open and prevent formation from closure. And second is to provide a high frac conductivity that ease formation fluid movement into the wellbore. There are two main types of used proppant: natural sand and man-made proppant. The right proppant selection is essential for optimizing well performance. It depends mainly on the expected downhole stress which the proppant will be subjected to and the required proppant pack permeability under the same subjected in-situ stress. Moving on to the equipment used in frac execution. As you can see from the picture, well site is quite busy with equipment. Let's summarize the frac surface equipment and the function of each unit. Storage tanks. They are used to receive and store frac fluid. Blending equipment. They are used to mix water with the required chemical and proppant and deliver the mixture to the high-pressure pumps. Proppant storage and delivery. It consists of a number of compartments that store proppant and deliver the proppant to blender through a conveyor belt. High-pressure pumps. There are a group of positive displacement pumps that are connected in parallel to pump the mixture at high pressure with a designed pumping rate. High-pressure treating lines. Pump mixture flow through the surface treating lines till it enters the well. The treating lines are designed to withstand the high treating pressure. Control van and quality assurance quality control lab. It gathers and monitors all data received from sensor attached to all used equipment during job execution. Some vans have a small lab to perform some of quality assurance tests on frac fluid and proppant. Finally, let's discuss the optimum candidates for hydraulic fracturing. Typically, wells that benefit from fracking are those which need the following. Enhance well productivity, especially for moderate to low permeability rocks. Frac can enhance well's productivity by several folds. Bypass near bore damage. When damaged zone is very deep from well bore or cannot be removed by any other stimulation method like matrix acidizing. Production acceleration. When maximizing production rate is needed, especially remaining hydrocarbon reserves and economics justify the frac and remedial work cost. In conclusion, hydraulic fracturing is a very powerful tool to unlock reserve and to manage reservoirs, as long as optimum candidate is identified and proper frac materials are used. With that, we conclude our lesson today. I hope you enjoyed the video and it was useful to you. If you have any questions or comments, or you want me to present a certain topic, please write it down on the comments. Or you can send me an email on petroleumbytes@gmail.com. Thanks for watching and see you next time.